I have started broadcasting, and my audio is included. Invite the game.
Oh, if the in-game invite is easier, let me know.
Oh god, let me turn off this fucking music. What the hell?
Okay.
Wee, you were able to join in quick.
Yeah, did good this time.
Good stuff. The world's biggest stunt.
This sounds like it's gonna be a bad fucking idea.
Yeah. Oh shit, here. Look, check it out.
Yeah.
Look, there's people. Hello, everyone. Yeah, no, that
I
was just
see
weird.
That screen, so I'll just take your word for it.
That's fine. So, after our cast 2 weeks ago, you had said, we're going to be talking about Beyond. Because you were just so excited to go to that show. And I sort of brushed it off like, yeah, all right. But we're not going to talk about that because nobody knows what Beyond is. It turns out that I agree having gone to that show because that was probably the single best wrestling show that I have ever been to. So, that's what I want to talk about tonight. Let's just talk about that show. Sound good to you?
And the Cruiserweight thing as well?
Of course we're going to talk about the Cruiserweight Classic.
Okay.
Actually, it's not of course. We were expected to talk about WrestleMania 3 this week. Here's why we made this decision. First of all, Beyond. The show was fucking incredible, and I want everybody to know about it. The Cruiserweight Classic because we did the first episode and then shifted to a bi-weekly format, but it left it on, like, an odd number of shows, if that makes any sense. So now, next week's cast was going to cover... By the way, I see weapons enabled. I'm not using weapons against you.
Yeah.
Next week's episode was going to be the final four matches of the first round and the first however many matches of the second round. And it's stupid. So if we do this single one episode of the Cruiserweight Classic, then it gets us back on track to keep doing the bi-weekly schedule. We're just going right up this fucking ramp. Just speed boost. Nothing but speed boost.
Yeah.
I really hope this isn't the whole race. So, oh, what the fuck?
Oh.
I don't know,
what
Eric.
What the fuck have we signed on for?
I don't know, Eric.
This race brought to you by every fucking game of Roller Coaster Tycoon we ever played.
Whee! Gurk! I can't believe I landed on my tires. Did you see how flippy I got? Gurk! Sorry, bud. Oh, shit, no. God, I'm sorry, but not that sorry. So, yeah, I don't even know what to say about Beyond. We went to Rhode Island, and it was about a two-hour and something drive to get there. Very long,
about
very
three.
Boring drive. But make sure you go to the left side of the tunnel. For God, what is this shit?
Yeah, this race is awful.
Yeah, it is. Ugh. This is why we can't have nice things, race creators. Fuck.
I'm fucking lost.
What was the first match at Beyond?
Let's see. Keith Lee defeated Brian Cage with a pop-up powerbomb.
Keith Lee. Ooh, Keith Lee. Oh, well, okay. You know, I remember that right after this match ended, you said it was probably not a good idea to have that match go on first because now every other match has to follow that one. And I don't know, 2-3 hours before everything else on the card happened, I agreed with you. I was like, yeah, that was really fucking short-sighted because I don't know how the hell they're going to follow that. And then they followed that, like, in spades.
Yeah.
But that match was fucking excellent. I'm pretty sure that match got a standing ovation. Brian Cage is just this gigantic fucking powerhouse looking wrestler that can do like standing moonsaults and shit like that. I'm pretty sure I've even seen him do a standing shooting star. Am I mistaken on that one?
I can't remember for sure if I've seen him do that. Definitely the standing moonsault. I can't remember the shooting star.
Okay. Bottom line, the guy is fucking ridiculous. He looks like the person that should be able to finally beat Lesnar, except he also does like a bunch of like flippy shit too, and like things that guys his size just should not be able to do. I feel like the same kind of applies to Keith Lee. Am I wrong?
No, I wouldn't say so. I mean, Keith Lee is a little less defined. He's built more like a fucking linebacker or something.
Yeah.
Like, whereas Brian Cage looks like a bodybuilder, but...
Am I wrong? Did you tell me at one point... Did you tell me at one point that he was a football player or no?
No, I don't believe he was.
Okay. I'm thinking about a past...
I'm really done.
...podcast. Holy shit, this thing just goes on. Oops! Killed myself. Was there something else we wanted to say about him? About Keith Lee?
Well, I was just saying, you know, even though he's not quite as cut as Brian Cage, neither of them really look like guys you would want to get into a fight with.
Yeah. Neither one looks like somebody you want to get into a fight with, and you wouldn't expect them to be flipping around that much and shit, but you'd be wrong. So the opening match of that show was really fucking strong. And by the way, as you have mentioned, this show is available on Beyond's YouTube channel, which I believe is a paid service. Do they have like a free trial or anything?
Yeah, I was going to say you get a 2-week free trial, and then it's $9.95 a month for basically every show they've ever put out.
Very, very worth it.
And I mean, they've been around for a few years. Yeah.
They have. As Eric has already told me, Sasha Banks, did you say she debuted there? That's where she did most of her work?
Not most of it, but she definitely competed there, so there's some Sasha Banks matches on there. Kevin Owens wrestled there a few times.
Didn't tell me that.
Wrestled Masada.
Woo-wee!
You know,
hey,
the,
I wonder, did anybody get punched in the face? The Young Bucks were there.
In the Masada match?
Yeah.
It would seem a safe bet, yes.
Did anybody bleed?
Absolutely, yes.
That's not surprising. Basically, what we're getting at is that a lot of quality wrestlers have gotten their start there, but have put a lot of work into that company. It's just a good company. Go on.
I was gonna say one of the, you know, main guys that runs Beyond was in fact a wrestler, so you know they kind of have that you know, I guess they take care of their guys well.
Yeah.
And it's just like a really cool atmosphere, like that you don't see over here too much, where the fans are encouraged to get right up against the ring.
Yeah.
Know, that's a lot of European companies do that, but like I say, there aren't too many that do it over here.
And we were up against the ring. It was a fun format, so. But yeah, like Eric said, free trial available, Beyond Wrestling on YouTube. Very fun company, and well, let's just keep talking about the show, because I could just go on and on about Beyond.
Okay.
We could just do the show.
All right, we're gonna do all the Iron Man title stuff in one shot later on. Okay.
Is that the heavy metalweight thing?
Segment. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so the next proper match was AR Fox versus Matt Tremont.
Ooh. Now, I know that you're not crazy about AR Fox. That he has things about
like
him.
I guess, yeah. I just... Yeah.
Please do go on.
He's good. I just felt like the way he was used in PWG kind of exposed him as being a little more underdeveloped than a lot of the other guys.
That's fair. Oh, what the fuck is this? Herc?
I just want this race to end, Tim. I've never hated a fucking race so much in
my
life.
At least it gets fun when you get to the, there's like a fucking stunt tube or whatever. Oh, God. Hoo-wee.
I'm still on the freeways.
Well, I saw Matt Tremont for the first time a couple of months ago, or possibly last year. Maybe, I don't know. Whatever. At
it was like the end of last year.
Wrestling, yeah. That was an awesome show.
Correct,
also,
yes.
By the way.
Yeah.
I saw him for the first time there. Oh, what the fuck? Just submerged my car. I'm okay, though. I saw him for the first time there, and I think he was a hardcore style wrestler. Am I wrong about that, or is he just like a brawlery type?
Yeah, he's... No, hardcore, CZW world champion. He's won like every deathmatch tournament there is.
So there you go. But, on this match, he was not doing anything deathmatchy. He was just a brawler, and I like that about him. He seemed, both at Fibro Wrestling and here, he adapted well to not, being in hardcore style matches.
Right.
I always like when someone can leave their own element to try and shine somewhere else, and he does. They work pretty well together.
He's got really
like,
nice punches.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I wonder why, Eric. It's probably because he's punching people in the face. Now, AR Fox is a pretty lean-looking fellow. Matt Tremont is not a lean-looking fellow. So the match just didn't really look fair, but it was a lot of fun. And do you want to talk about the thing, or should I?
Well, we'll get to it. I mean, the match in general was, for the most part, Tremont was in control in the ring. You know, hit like a lot of like big like power type stuff. Then he kind of, rolled with AR Fox to the outside, and AR Fox got to be, a crazy bastard. Remember, he did a diving leg drop off the stage. He was on the apron, and he ran to the ring post and backflipped off.
Yes.
So he kind of took control.
Shit.
Yeah, kind of took control on the outside, which Tremont wasn't expecting. And, he eventually managed to hold off Tremont long enough to put him down. And from there, he climbed up into the balcony and did a swanton off of a 15 to 20 foot balcony onto Matt Tremont in the ring.
Mm-hmm.
So. And thankfully,
absolutely
that was the
horrifying.
End of the match. Yeah.
Alright. Because
he didn't have a lot of overhead space.
Yeah.
He was practically hitting his head on a support beam. So it was kind of amazing that he was able to get the flip and everything without hitting his noggin.
Alright. This is going to be annoying, but we're going to go back to free mode, and then I'm going to try and load up with a different custom race. Because it looks like the custom races are not going to show up on this list.
Right. Although I don't remember a lot of those races that were there.
Yeah, well, I think a lot of those were not stunt races. They just said regular race on them and shit.
Gotcha.
I mean, we could do regular races if you want, but this is just more stunt races.
I do not.
That was where we were positioned in the building. We saw fucking AR Fox goes soaring right over our heads. That, like, yeah, I backed up underneath the balcony because if anything went wrong, I didn't want to die by a guy landing on me. I probably would have saved his life from the cushioning, but yeah. It was scary to see a guy go flying overhead. It's just like, it's not something you expect to see. It was not a comforting feeling to see him up there. I'm glad it turned out well for him that he didn't get hurt, that Matt Tremont didn't get hurt, because that must have been a scary fucking bump for him, too.
It can't be fun to have that landing on you.
Yeah. It all worked out well, and it looked fucking awesome. On to the next match.
Okay, now we had the 9-man tag. It was supposed to be a 10-man tag, but one of the members of one of the teams had a family emergency and was not able to stay for the show. So, you know, technically a 5-on-4 handicap match, but they never really played it up due to basically who the four members were. So we had a team strong style of Homicide, Eddie Kingston, Mafia, and B-Boy against the Crusade for Change of Darius Carter, TJ Marconi, Anthony Gagnon, and the Minutemen. Do you want to start on this one, Tim?
I would rather not. This is one of the matches that I remember the least. I remember lots and lots of brawling. I remember at one point, everybody inexplicably disappeared. And we didn't know where to focus anymore. We could not see. There was nobody in the ring. They were all brawling.
That was a different match.
Wait, I'm sorry, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
That was the three-way match.
Oh, yeah, I remember about this one. Lots of, a couple of scary stage spots. I think I remember a dive or two to the outside. And lots of brawling on the outside. Like, we were up against the ring. That's the first match where we were forced to move back from the ring. Not only from people getting in and out of the ring, but also... everybody on the first team, I can't remember what you called them. They're
the team strong style, or the...
Yeah, they're a little reckless when it comes to people in general. So, by the way, the fucking description recommends the T20. I don't know.
Okay.
So, yeah, so they were just scary to be around. But we didn't get killed, so it was okay.
Yeah, although I did have to pull you clear of Homicide's dive.
Yes. And I'm glad you did. I'm for some reason, very stupid on my feet. So even though, like, my brain is being like, okay, this guy's about to come our way, you need to move. My fucking dumb feet are just getting tangled up over each other like... so you took care of me on that one. Thank you. I didn't tell you that at the time, by the way.
Right.
Not trying to bump you here. I just... Gravity.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck. It's another one of these.
Hell, it's another one. Yeah, my words exactly. Oh, well, God, it's worse because I see a track below me.
Yeah. I'm gonna blow up.
Now!
Well, I didn't blow up, but I did fall off the side, so. Oh, good, let's jump it again.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was hoping to do.
That just might have been one of my least favorite matches on the card. Yeah, it just was not, like... I mean, of course, I wasn't expected to be a technical thing or anything like that. But, you know, very brawl-ish and violent. And at one point, Eddie Kingston
grabbed a chair near us, started smashing it on the floor and on the corner post. What the fuck? Okay, whatever. And it's one of those like plastic chairs, and I couldn't figure out why the hell, like, why is he doing this exactly? And the reasoning was that there's a little metal support piece underneath the chair, and he was smashing the chair up so that he could get to that metal piece, and then he was going to use that metal piece to slice open one of his opponents. And I didn't ever catch if he actually did. I don't think he did. Am I right?
No, he got to him a little bit with it.
Okay. I didn't see any blood, so I'm glad that we
I think there was a little bit, but it wasn't.
Yeah.
But I mean, I don't know. I did personally enjoy the match. I thought
it was
nice.
Fun.
You know, because that's what like I've liked about the Beyond shows I've been to. Is it kind of a lot of different styles of matches are usually on display.
Yeah. They try to do a little bit of everything.
Yeah. I mean, this totally felt like an old like ECW brawl or something. God damn it.
Oh, fuck. Oh, hell. Gurg! Fuck! Gurg. What was the following match?
Oh, and for anyone that cares, Darius Carter rolled up B-Boy for the pin.
Oh, yes.
Let's see. God fucking damn it, I keep blowing up in the same spot. These custom races are fucking retarded.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I just flew over my checkpoint.
After that was pretty much the main one of the matches I didn't care for. Chris Hero defeated Kimberly.
Oy.
Now, yeah, Beyond Wrestling does a lot of intergender matches. But as we were discussing after the show, I don't feel that it works when there's this much of a size disparity. Like, I think when it's a smaller guy, it can kind of work.
For the love of God.
Oh, holy shit.
A smaller guy or a bigger woman. Like, just,
right.
Like you said, the disparity is the killer. Motherfucker.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Because Kimberly is not a large girl, and Crisio is a large man.
It's true. It's true. Mad Funyuns. I mean, I don't know, because, like, on top of, like, I don't like the concept of the match, I wasn't really appreciating the way, like, you know, at certain points she finally got, a handle on him, like.
Right, would fire like up a little.
Yeah, she'd fire up a little bit, and then he'd just start being like, wait, I don't have to sell this, I'm a man. The whole match structure, and like I mean, I called the last one of my least favorites. This was probably my least favorite. The match structure on this one was just fucking, like, not good. Because, you know, you go into one of these matches, and you know to expect the unexpected. You're like, okay, so it's an intergender match. That means that the woman is probably going to take it. The woman very much did not take it. She took many forearms to the back of the head and face. She was much smaller than Hero. Whenever she mounted any kind of offense, he would just say, I mean, like, no, I'm the guy. I'm not going to do that. It was just, not well put together. And it made you uncomfortable to see it.
Yeah.
So, I doubt anybody from Beyond is watching this. They probably never will be. If somebody from Beyond happens to come across this video one day, please knock it off. Don't do that anymore. I don't like it. Did you have anything you wanted to contribute? I feel like I might have said everything.
No, it just wasn't great.
Yeah. Fucking hell. There's a wall ride part coming up, and it is the worst. I can't figure out how to do it.
Well, now that I got that fucking loop-de-loop on my 40th attempt, I'll check this out.
Oh, yeah, the purple loop?
Yeah.
It's a bitch, right?
Yeah, it was.
Okay. Oh, shit. I think I might have got it. Nope. Whee! Off the side I go. What was the next match?
Okay, let's see. Matt Riddle defeats John Silver.
Matt Riddle. Matt Riddle is a name that probably does not ring a bell for anybody. But for the few people... For the few people that might say, hang on, no, I recognize that name. He won the second season of The Ultimate Fighter?
I don't know which season he won, but yeah, he won The Ultimate Fighter, he competed in UFC, and was terminated. Or, as near as anyone can tell, drug-related reasons.
Yeah,
the boy likes his marijuana.
The man likes his marijuana, the man likes saying bro. That's it. You say bro too much. I'm cutting you off. Matt Riddle is someone that within the last 2-3 years maybe.
I would say last two, yeah.
Damn it! I almost had it. So somewhat recently decided to transition.
Is this fucking possible?
I almost made it, so it's gotta be. Just, ugh, God. Anyway, so recently tried to transition into pro wrestling. And the first time we saw him was at Evolve. Probably right after he was, like, starting to train, right?
He was still pretty new.
Yeah. And it showed, and... Basically, I was like, this is the stupidest fucking thing. Like, this dude is not a wrestler. And I was just like, nothing that he did seemed any good. I was like, this fucking sucks. I was not looking forward to seeing him again. And then I was told that that he'd very much improved. I'm like, all right, let's check it out. And the next time we saw him was what? Five-star wrestling? Or five-borough wrestling?
No, probably another Evolve show.
Do you remember who his matches at Evolve were against?
No.
Yeah, me neither. Oh, well.
Like, I know who I've... I kind of have a recollection of who we've seen him wrestle, but I couldn't tell you which one was what.
Oh, okay. Well, we'll get to that. Or maybe we won't, whatever. Anyway, the first time we saw him, I was like, this is bad. Like, he's not ready for this. The second time we saw him wrestle, it was like it was a different person wearing his fucking skin. He was so much better and, like, just so entertaining to watch. And I've been a fan ever since, and I've seen him a couple more times since then, and he has not let me down. He's getting, like, better at an incredible rate. Not sure if you guys know, but
you actually passed this fucking thing?
Yes, I did. It just took, like, very slight steering adjustments. If you make a big adjustment, you're going to spin out and just fall off.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, hell. Oh, I don't like this angle that I'm falling at. Oh, what's happening? Oh, shit, I fixed it.
So I kind of fucking hate all these custom races. Let's not do any more of these.
Man, that was the point of these. That was the point
of
this.
Yeah, but they suck.
Thing.
Let's just go to.
Let's try one more, one more match, Eric. Gurk. Matt Riddle, and yeah, like I say, he's just gotten so entertaining, and he hasn't let me down ever since. that first match where he let me down. John Silver, he had a fun match with this guy. I really enjoyed it. Yeah. Shit, I'm gonna blow up like hell. Kirk?
Yeah, John Silver, in beyond circles, has kind of been considered a breakout star. He's having a great year. He had a really good match with Keith Lee at the first Beyond show we went to. And he was like more of a tag guy. He was actually like a CZW tag team champion.
Oh,
and briefly a PWG tag team champion.
Also didn't know that.
Yeah. And branching out more as a singles wrestler now.
He's a very short man, but he's a really solid wrestler.
Yeah, and really strong looking for a little guy.
Yeah. And Riddle, I mean, like, basically whatever Riddle does, I'm in. That if they say at the next show Riddle is fighting this guy, I'm like, I'm a watch that match. I don't care. I heard Matt Riddle, so I'm good. He's just one of those guys. In this match, he showed that, like, he actually knew how to mat wrestle. And, you know, he's smart with his submissions and just, like, his instincts. I think he's going to be all right.
Yeah.
Oh, you poor bastard. You're still struggling on this. Feck. Whee! What was I saying? Oh yeah, I was gonna say that
I mean,
you guys may or may not know that Evolve is they're affiliated with the WWE at this point. They're basically the developmental territory for WWE since NXT was the developmental territory, but now it's sort of its own thing. It's just like popular, and
they've
they
said they can just consider it another brand.
Yeah. So I mean, it was originally intended to be the practice for people to, like.
How the fuck are you back here?
It's another lap. Oh.
What?
Please calm down, because please calm down. So yeah, since NXT is really its own entity, they went out and commissioned their own independent organization to basically be their developmental territory. And
yeah, they actually, with Evolve, they kind of have say over who they book and everything.
Yeah. Basically, they only. I'm pretty sure they only are allowed to book people that, like, that the E is seriously considering, right?
Or
have they backed off that?
No, I believe that's still kind of the stance.
Yeah. And they did some qualifying matches for the Cruiserweight Classic at Evolve. We were there for two of those matches.
Yeah, I think they did about four total.
Anyway, where I was getting is that Matt Riddle has done a lot of work with that company. They are definitely very interested in him, and I am interested in them getting him, because he's only getting better every time we see him. It's really impressive. Every single time we see him, he's just getting better and better, and that's what I like to see. John Silver, I'd love to see him with a contract at some point. He's small. He's I know they've been hiring some small people, but he's small.
Yeah, but you know what? He's probably no smaller than, like, Austin Aries.
That's true. Austin Aries is a short fuck. Oh, God. This really is frustrating. But that was a good match. Like you said, both very technically sound.
Yeah, a lot of striking.
Yeah. Okay. Ah, shit!
What the absolute fuck?
Hey, how's it going? Oh, God. Let me see if I can help you work a strategy for, like, basically, are you gunning it right as soon as you leave the ramp?
Yeah.
Oh God, that seems like an easy way to lose it. Maybe ease off the gas for a split second as soon as you come off the ramp.
I've tried that, then you just don't stick to the wall.
Yeah. I'm gonna get over this ramp. This wall ride, and then we'll keep talking about it.
Yeah. Whoever made this level, suck my fucking dick.
Suck my dick. Go fuck yourself. Me first.
Fuck you, we die together.
No, we don't. God damn it. Stupid thing, how's it going? Try to crash into me. Okay, that was a poor attempt. Holy shit. Oh, no, shit. Damn it.
Okay.
Yeah, I guess we probably better go on, because this is going to take a while.
For our next match, we have a triple threat, where Donovan Dijak defeated Chris Dickinson and JT Dunn. This was the match where they completely fucking disappeared.
Yeah. And I don't know where the third person went. I think only two people came back, right? After the fucking the crowd brawl.
I don't remember.
Yeah, it was
This match was kinda I mean it was kinda the thing behind it was supposed to be to determine who was the ace of Beyond Wrestling. And I've seen pretty much all these guys have better matches.
Huh. So happy to say I just went soaring over your head. I saw that you made the fucking wall ride, but then just crashed out too soon, right?
Yep.
Yeah, it's a pain in the ass. Alright, well, I have one more checkpoint to hit, and then it's the finish line, so 30 seconds after that, we'll be done. Yeah, this match was not memorable. I like JT Dunn. Donovan Dijak is alright. Who's the
Chris Dickinson.
Oh yeah, Chris Dickinson was kind of fun, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He was the fucking get hyped guy that's gonna be fighting Riddle next, right?
Yes.
Getting up in his face, he's like, I don't give a fuck about the UFC, let's fucking go. Then everybody else had to jump in the ring and be like, whoa, 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 hey, calm down now. Calm down.
Well, it's like Pinky said, Chris Dickinson is great at making wrestling uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Because he just seems like a big fucking, you know, muscled up dude with, you know, a martial arts background and anger issues.
Okay, back to regular stunt races.
Fuck all of this.
Back to regular stunt races. Yeah, that's all I have to say.
Oh, actually, by the way, we did the order wrong. The Matt Riddle was after that match.
Well, that's good. Needed something to get the fucking sour taste out of our mouths anyway. So,
yeah.
Do you want to talk more about Matt Riddle and John Silver instead of the three-way?
I mean, you know, it was just a solid match. Like I say, a lot of striking, a lot of good mat wrestling. Very entertaining. Then we had the six-man tag of Team Pazuzu, Jaka, Angel Ortiz, and Mike Drastic against Catchpoint of Drew Gulak, TJP, and Tracy Williams.
I like TJP. Tim. He shares my initials.
Yeah, TJP is fucking awesome.
He's awesome and he shares my initials. Oh yeah, I don't remember much about that match. I remember that it was good. I definitely remember enjoying it. Drew Gulak is someone that I was not crazy about up to this point, but he was impressive in this match. And
yeah,
the
very very technically sound.
Yeah, and in the Cruiserweight Classic also, we'll be talking about that.
Mm-hmm.
I think you see this is a rock star created one.
Yeah, TJP is always good, and Tracy Williams, kind of like, you know, what Tim was saying about how guys you don't like much, Tracy Williams looked really fucking good here, because he usually wrestles a very similar mat wrestling style, similar to Gulak, but for whatever reason here, he was just handing out these awesome looking lariats left and right, and I preferred that very much.
Yeah.
And then Team Pazuzu is guys like a couple of months ago I really knew nothing about, but they've impressed me every time I've seen them, so
yeah,
good for them.
Bam.
Have hopefully a bright future ahead of them.
I think they'll be alright. Don't give Pinky money, he's just gonna drink with it.
That's okay.
No, it's not. I like Pinky. I don't want him to die. Pinky, we're worried about you. We love you.
Oh, Jesus Christ. It's not that bad.
What was the next match?
And Team Pazuzu won.
Team Pazuzu won with, what the fuck is his name? What do they call him?
Who, Jaka?
That's what they call
it. That's the Yao guy.
Yeah, Yao! Oh. But, the guy wearing the mask, which is Pinky.
Yeah, that was Pinky. Yeah.
Okay. Yep, he last show we went to in Massachusetts, Pinky sort of fucked them over.
Yeah, he accidentally distracted them and cost them the match.
Yeah. In this one, he helped. He distracted the right people. And then
he distracted Gulak. And Gulak fell to a double team move. I think Drastic and Ortiz lifted him kind of like a neck breaker sort of thing, and then Jaka splashed him or double stomped him.
Oh, Eric, I'm still on the map. Ooh, I'm okay. Jesus Christ.
But yeah, it was very fun match.
Yeah, it was a fun match, and those guys are charismatic, and they can wrestle.
Yeah.
They got futures ahead of them.
Yeah, they're all pretty young, too, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, they got time to get better and get seen by the right people, hopefully.
Just hoping. Business is heading in an interesting direction that way, so...
Yeah.
What was the next match?
David Starr defeats Johnny Gargano.
Hoo-wee. This was the fucking Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn of our Beyond experience.
Yeah.
To this
point,
I'll let you go ahead. Yeah.
All right. The backstory behind this match was this was Americanrana, which is like basically Beyond Wrestling's WrestleMania, more or less. At last year's version of this event, David Starr cheated, knocked out Johnny Gargano with a foreign object, and then put Gargano in his own finishing hold. And, you know, he was already unconscious, so David Starr has been talking crap about how he made Johnny Gargano tap out, which he didn't. He just cheated and knocked him out and then put him in the hold. So
I know
that
this.
Was, you know, yeah, kind of researched it a little bit. So that was the backstory going into the match. David Starr being the cocky asshole and Johnny Gargano being, you know, the baby face that was screwed over. Alright, so whatever you were going to say before, Tim, go ahead.
Try and talk a little bit more because I forgot what I was going to say.
Okay, so yeah, it was, you know, just the standard baby face looking for revenge sort of thing.
To this point, Me and you have not liked Gargano. We felt like he had gotten a lot of attention that he didn't deserve because he named himself Johnny Wrestling. They're like, oh, this guy is wrestling in his name. Like, he must be awesome. But then we watch him in PWG, and I was just never really blown away. He was, like, pretty plain in, like, everything he did. And I was like, I don't get it. Finally, he got offered a contract to NXT, and my mind is blown. I'm like, there's so many guys that should have been there before him. But anyway, this was where he proved his salt, and my God, the match was fucking incredible. That after the show, you and me both had to walk up to Gargano, who was, you know, still doing signatures, stuff like that, and we had to shake his hand, say that was one of the best matches I've ever seen. Congratulations, you deserve whatever you have coming to you, and sincerely fucking mean it. I did.
Yeah.
I don't think I remember, like, a single thing about the match, but I remember that it was, like, fucking, like, mind-blowingly good, and I told this motherfucker that match blew my mind. Like, excellent work.
Well, the pretty much the story of the match was, you know, they were, you know, like I've already explained the background. As the match went on, there came a point where the referee was down, and David Starr took out a foreign object and prepared to do Johnny dirty again, and then actually said, you know what, I'm going to beat you fair, and put down the foreign object. A few seconds later, Gargano picked it up, hit him with it, and tried slapping him in the submission hold. So basically repeating what had happened
exactly
to him
the
year before.
To him.
And David Starr managed to fight out, and from then on the match had that new dimension. That was basically both guys had turned now, as Gargano was pretty much yelling to the crowd that, you know, he's done with this indie wrestling crap. He doesn't need anyone's approval anymore because he's going to NXT, so it doesn't matter what any of us think.
Yeah.
And David Starr was able to come back and fairly defeat Johnny Gargano with a different submission that was something along the lines of an inverted sharpshooter with like a almost a cross face to it. It was nasty looking, but it was awesome. Yeah, I mean, you know, the explanations don't do it justice. You really should just watch it for yourselves. You know, like I say, it's free for that first 2 weeks. You know, give Beyond a try, see if you like it. But definitely watch this match. Watch this whole show, but especially this match.
Said it all. Let me see. You know, basically, I was gonna say that Gargano's, I think, final appearance for Beyond, right?
Yes.
He's wrapping up his indie appearances because he's been offered a full contract. He works for the WWE now. He's just finishing up his indie days, and then he goes to NXT.
I believe his official last show is in September, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay. So basically, the match was about passing the baton to David Starr.
Yeah.
And, you know, what he really wanted to get out of him was just like a fucking show-stopping match. And they made it. Like, they put together, just like I said, an incredible match together.
Yeah.
David Starr, you know, like I said, at the first show we went to, he had sort of a comedy match with Ciampa.
Yeah. I don't know if I'd call it a comedy match. It definitely had a lot of comedic elements to it, but then became a serious match.
Yeah.
It was interesting. It was a different structure to a match, I'll say.
Yeah. Like I said, I didn't remember much from that match because I remembered, like, a lot of comedy stuff, and I sort of tuned out to it being, like, a technical masterpiece.
Yeah.
Like, for example, David Starr likes to ask other wrestlers to look at it. And by it, yep, he's referring to his penis.
Yep. Puts them in a sitting position and runs crotch first into their face.
It's true. So, he stops in the middle of the match with Ciampa, and he says to him, I'm going to do the normal thing. I'm going to yell, look at it, and then run to the ropes, and then I'm going to fucking, like, hit my crotch
gently
against your face.
Well, no, the exact words he used were, gently and seductively touch my penis to your forehead.
Okay. So, he looked up the exact wording, or remembers the exact wording. It was just that enthralling.
I do. It was one of the funniest fucking thing I'd ever seen.
So, he runs to the ropes, and he begins to gently and seductively run his penis toward Ciampa's face. When he realizes that Ciampa has his mouth open, he actually wants to become Tommaso Ciampa, and he wants to chomp. It was just that kind of match. Like I said, I stopped paying attention to the wrestling of it, and I was like, alright, this is a comedy match. I'm just going to enjoy it for what it is. And I didn't really pay attention to how either of them were as wrestlers in that match. And it was a big fucking mistake because David Starr knows how to wrestle. He's very good. And he proved it during that match with Gargano. I am definitely looking forward to seeing more of David Starr in the future. And, you know, after the match, Gargano... Oh, wait, no, I'm sorry. He didn't grab a microphone because Dijak apparently spilled water on the sound system. It's okay. You'll get him next time, champ. So, yeah, that's... We'll get back to, because there's a couple of things that we forgot about that triple threat match anyway. He basically said, you know, everything that I did during that match aside, I love this company, and, you know, he's like, I just want to know that it's in good hands, and from everything that I've seen so far, and from the match that I just had with David Starr, I know that the company is in good hands, and yeah, the company is in pretty fucking good hands.
You beat me by less than a tenth of a second.
Yes. I beat you by 0.04 of a second, which is fine. Or I'm sorry, wait, by less than a tenth of a second? No.
Yep.
Oh, fuck. Anyway. Anyway, the important thing is you lost, so let's go to the forest.
Okay.
I
guess we'll move on.
Well, we're going to go back a little bit because, like I said, we missed a couple of things that I remembered.
We'll do the DDT Iron Man heavy metal weight title stuff now.
No, we will wait a second because I want to go back. I said I want to go back. Remember?
Okay.
So I'm going to go back. During the triple threat match, we missed that. Like, you know, like I said, at some point, we realized that the wrestlers were up on the balcony above us, and we didn't know what the hell they were doing. And then we just sort of lost sight of them. Apparently, while that was all going on, Donovan Dijak had spilled some water onto the sound system.
I think he actually threw JT Dunn over the soundboard, and some stuff got knocked over.
I see. Well, either way, something was spilled onto the soundboard. We had no more music or microphones to deal with, so that was weird. And I also, just in that same triple threat match, I also wanted to mention the stuff with the referee and JT Dunn and everything like that. That was, I thought that was kind of fun.
Yeah, that was pretty cool. I forgot about that.
I'll let you.
Okay, well, there had been a recurring storyline where all of the referees refused to work with JT Dunn because he had knocked out all of them at various points, you know, and he didn't get his way or whatever, he didn't like the call. So, a gentleman by the name of Brian Malonis was assigned to be his particular referee. Brian Malonis is probably about 6'5 and 350 pounds. JT Dunn is not.
It's true.
So, but he had still... JT Dunn is also Chris Hero's tag team partner. So Hero would kind of back him up, and, you know, they've still been screwing with this ref despite his size, like sneak attacking him and elbowing in the back of the head and shit. And this was finally the show where he got his revenge and chokeslammed JT Dunn and kind of slapped him around a little bit, finally.
True. I think he had a crossbody on him at one point, didn't he?
Yes, he did, the running crossbody. And I think he also refused to count a pinfall for him at one point.
Oh, did he? What a dick. That's too far. I'm not on board anymore. That's mean. Anyway.
I think Dijak actually technically got pinned by JT Dunn, and the ref just refused to count it.
Let's see.
JT Dunn also did a crossbody out of the balcony.
Oh yeah, vaguely I remember that.
Some action.
Whee! That was like... It was less entertaining because, you know, he was on like... I don't even know how to describe it. It just wasn't as impressive a jump as what AR Fox did.
Yeah.
Let's leave it at that. Instead of me trying to describe exactly what the hell happened.
Well, also, I mean, with JT Dunn's, he basically just had to step out of the balcony and the guys were right there underneath him.
Yeah.
AR Fox had to clear a front flip and actually land it.
Yeah. And also, JT Dunn was not jumping into the ring. He was jumping just, like, gently into someone's arms that was waiting for him on the floor.
Basically, yeah.
And it did seem like a gentle jump. Like, you know, like I said, I don't hate JT Dunn or anything like that. I have no problem with JT Dunn. But that was... He basically just stepped off the balcony and we were like,
yeah,
what a dive. Anyway, so yeah, we can move on to the heavy metal weight, Iron Man, something, whatever.
Okay, so for anyone that has seen anything Joey Ryan's done on social media, he has a belt that I'm not going to keep saying the name of because it's too fucking long.
Can you say it one time?
the DDT, where is it? Iron Man Heavy Metal Weight Belt. It's defended under, you know, old WWF 24/7 rules. So, you know, basically he's had belts of, I mean, he's had a video of, like, his cat winning the title. And, you know, it's seen a lot of champions, we'll just say.
Okay.
So, when the show started, Shug D, formerly known as Sugar Dunkerton, had apparently won the title earlier in the day at some point. Because Joey Ryan was the champion upon arriving at the building earlier that day. So, they had a very brief encounter where Joey Ryan informed Shug D to touch his dick first thing out of the match.
Yeah.
Because as most people have probably seen, Joey Ryan does a test of strength with his penis.
True.
Shug D refused on grounds that I don't even know you.
I just want to say that because right as soon as the match started, the referee calls for the bell, and Joey Ryan looks at him and says, "First things first, touch my dick." So we just knew right then that we were off to a good start with this match. You can continue.
And the first encounter ended when Shug D scampered off after Joey Ryan pulled a blow pop out of his tights and approached him to put it in Shug D's mouth, the blow pop we're talking about here.
Yeah. And Shug D said, oh, hell no, and he ducked down under the bottom rope and ran. He just ran.
Yep. At some point later in the show, they ended up back in the ring. After a little...
There's somebody else involved too, right?
Yeah, we're getting to that.
Okay.
After a short little skirmish, they both ended up down. And Tanya Cornell, who is their video lady for Beyond Wrestling... pinned Shug D to become the, you know, new champion. Let's see, and then I believe she had lost it again somehow. Not exactly certain how that happened. It must have been at intermission or something. And I believe Shug D ended up with the belt again. Joey Ryan ended up with it. I don't know. A lot of people ended up with it.
It's true.
So Joey Ryan was chased. Oh no, that's right. Johnny Cockstrong had won it.
Sure.
So Johnny Cockstrong is chased into the ring by Joey Ryan, Shug D, and Candice LeRae. Let's see. Pretty much, I think how it went from there. There's a lot to remember, folks. I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm.
So, basically everyone was beating up Joey Ryan. Joey Ryan then used his magical abilities to freeze time. Rearranged his attackers so that they all attacked each other. And he scored the pinfall and regained his title. Then he did a brief speech where he said this belt belongs more to the fans than it does to him. The referee ruled that a forfeit and made the audience the new DDT blah 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 champion.
It's true. And
crowd
then
chanted, pounded on the ring apron and such, and lost the title by tap out as they pounded the apron.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the end of that. Joey Ryan regained his title.
It's an awesome segment, an awesome series of segments.
Yeah.
Joey
really
Ryan.
Fun.
Joey Ryan is someone that I've been aware of for a very long time, but never got to see him in person. And to be there and see him and just, like, have him be himself, which is just a funny motherfucker, it was quite a joy. It was a big treat for us.
Yeah,
I hope we get to see more of him in the future.
Mm-hmm. It's, you know, some people get mad because of the things he does. Oh, he's killing pro wrestling. But, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. It's fun. It's something different.
Yeah.
It's not like everyone fucking believes pro wrestling is 100% real anyway, so you may as well have some fun with it and do different things on your shows, you know?
99% of the people that go to these indie shows know the deal, so...
Right. I mean, like, I feel like, say, like, Chikara kind of overdoes it where everything is kind of silly and then they'll have, like, one realistic angle and it's weird, but... Again, I think a couple of segments, like the way this was done, were sprinkled throughout the show and was, you know, kind of broke up, you know, the matches. I think it was really well done.
Yeah.
All right. Our final two matches... Brian Fury defeats Tommaso Ciampa with a Boston Crab.
Yeah.
Not a bad match, just felt a little basic. I feel like they're both capable of more.
Yeah. That's why
I mean, Brian Fury is not a flashy wrestler. He's solid, but he's not spectacular, in my opinion. Maybe I've not seen the right matches, but that's just the impression I get. Ciampa I usually enjoy, and I mean, he did his awesome strikes here, but it felt like a match that would have opened a show, I'll say that much.
Yeah.
Not been the semi-main event. And the finish was kind of weird because Brian Fury's finisher is, you know, just a Boston Crab, and it seemed like Ciampa tapped out immediately after being put into it, which was kind of just strange the way it was. Like, really? That's it? Okay.
Yeah. It felt out of nowhere, and I was not crazy about it.
Yeah.
Like I said, like it ruined the entire match just because, like that's it, though? A crab? Anyway.
You know, like, I didn't love the match, but I can't say it was bad or anything. Just, yeah. You know. Who knows? On another show, it might have come off differently. But for the levels of quality and craziness that we had seen, but to this point, it was, you know, it was probably just in the wrong spot, I would say. But Brian Fury's retiring soon, and this was Ciampa's last Beyond show, so you couldn't really put it low on the card.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Why is Brian Fury retiring?
He's been wrestling for a long time, and I guess he just decided enough's enough. Maybe he has injuries. I haven't heard the specifics. I just know that he's only wrestling until the end of October or so, if I remember correctly.
I see. Alright.
Then in our main event, Zack Sabre Jr.
Yeah.
Was defeated in a 2 out of 3 falls match by Jonathan Gresham.
Yeah. I'm less excited about that one.
Really?
What, about being defeated?
Oh, well, yeah. I just thought you meant the match itself.
No. The match, I never got the chance to see Zack Sabre Jr. up that close, because by this point we had gotten right up against the ring apron, and we're basically felt like we were just like in the ring. And yeah, to see him work his magic just up that close, I'm probably the biggest Zack Sabre Jr. mark in the world, and I sort of look like him too, and he agrees. Except he thinks I'm more handsome. That's what he said. But it was a good match. They gave up. They gave up the first fall together, and I feel like it was like an overhead belly to belly pin type of thing.
Like a German suplex, yeah.
Oh, was it a German? Okay, with the shoulders down. For both men, so yeah.
Actually, I believe it was a tiger suplex, now that I think about it.
I don't remember.
Because I seem to recall that the arms were chicken winged.
Yeah. So I thought I remembered that, I don't even know what the fuck you call that suplex. The one where, God. Like, you put your head under one of their arms and just fucking lift them over with your shoulder. Does that make any sense?
It sounds like a Northern Lights.
Yeah, the Northern Lights. That's exactly. I thought it was the Northern Lights that did it.
No.
Okay.
I don't know if you can both have your shoulders down from a Northern Lights.
That's true. Yeah, you know what? The tiger suplex does seem to make the most sense. I'm going to go with that. Tiger suplex, final answer. Did we get it?
Yeah, I'll go with that.
Okay.
So,
woohoo!
Yeah, and then we just got really intense for the third fall, because whoever won it was going to win the match at this point.
Yep.
A lot of, like, really solid body part work where, Gresham had his arm attacked by Zack Sabre. And Sabre was going after... I mean, Gresham was going after Zack Sabre's neck.
Yeah.
And it was just,
a ton of psychology in that match.
Right. Yeah, it was just very interesting because, you know, you could see both of them kind of being hesitant to use certain moves because they knew they'd be damaging themselves. This is another great match on this show that was already loaded with them.
It was the sprinkles on the ice cream cone.
Yeah.
It was an absolute joy to go to that show with you. Beyond, if you're paying attention, we'd love to have you in New York. We got plenty of arenas. That the Hammerstein Ballroom, I could get in touch with them for you, or not. The Best Buy Theater, I'm pretty sure they are still a thing.
Yeah, I think it's I believe it's the PlayStation Theater now, actually.
Oh yeah, PlayStation Theater. Anyway, yeah, I'd love to see them in New York, because I definitely want to go to more of their stuff.
They actually did, like, a joint show with House of Glory a couple of weeks ago, but we were busy. I'll come fucking
were we
on.
Actually, were we actually busy, or,
Yeah. Without going into things, yes, we were.
Okay.
It's, you don't want to.
Still trying. Just trying to remember. Anyway. Yeah, excellent show. And, like I say, I was hesitating to talk about the show itself on the podcast, but good call. Because we definitely needed to talk about that.
Yeah. So, once again, youtube.com/beyonddemand.
BEYOND. Emand.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that was that Beyond show.
Yeah.
Who wants to talk about the Cruiserweight Classic?
Okay. Let's see, we'll get that now. Okay, so let's see. This week, I believe our first match was Rich Swann versus Jason Lee.
Rich Swann versus. Well, I don't remember much about Jason Lee, but I do remember a lot about Rich Swann.
Yep.
That guy is fucking awesome.
Yeah, I mean, as of when the tournament was first announced, I believe he was the only one that was actually under a WWE contract.
And now, but, he's under a contract even harder.
Yeah, if he was before, this would have gotten it for him.
Yeah.
He just comes off super likable, just loaded with charisma and personality.
Lots of dance moves. And, yeah. I mean, lots of wrestling moves. Everything he does looks fucking clean, and all the athletic shit that he did, like, my God. That guy's a fucking machine. He closed out that match with us. I mean, well, no, if you were going to talk about the match, then I'm not going to talk about the ending just yet. Go on.
I feel like it was pretty much just a showcase for Swan.
Yeah. What else can you say?
Yeah.
He closed out the match against Jason Lee with a standing 450 splash, which is a thing that people can do, apparently. Because he did it. What else happened, Eric?
Let's see. Because I don't have the proper results, I just have the, the brackets in front of me.
Okay, well,
I believe our next one was, Noam Dar and Gurv Sira. This was pretty much, without a doubt, the worst match of the first round.
Yeah.
I've heard a lot of talk about Noam Dar, so I'm not gonna fully judge him off this performance, but goddamn, this was not a good first impression.
No, that match fucking sucked.
Yeah, just
people
like
were making mistakes. They looked like they had bad instincts.
Yeah, no, just a lot of timing issues and style problems.
Yeah, I'm not looking forward to seeing either one of them in the next round. Who was next, sir?
This was Fabian Aichner and Jack Gallagher.
Jack Gallagher.
Yep. Now, on the complete opposite fucking side of the coin was another British gentleman, or from the UK.
Who?
Jack Gallagher, who was a manly gentleman. Yep.
Is he actually from England? I didn't know that.
I believe he is.
Huh.
I have to double check, but I'm like 99% sure.
I thought he was just one of those weird guys that likes to grow the fucking mustache that you could twist up at the end.
No. I'm pretty sure he was representing the UK.
Okay.
But this was a nice palate cleanser after that last one.
Yeah.
As Gallagher looked great, and Fabian Aichner, for a guy I never heard of, was actually really impressive.
Yeah.
The big, muscly-looking dude, and he did an awesome double springboard moonsault.
I do remember that. You know, because it has been a thing that we talked about a lot, that basically for all the first-round matches, we could properly predict who exactly it was that they wanted to go on.
To showcase, uh-huh.
And in every single match, every single one, we were right. But they showcased both these guys in this match.
Yeah.
And they were definitely plugging Gallagher pretty heavy, but...
Yeah, he's definitely a little more established, but...
Yeah.
Like I said, Eichner definitely is someone that improved his standings in the wrestling world with this match.
Yeah. You listen to the announcers. I mean, the announcers are the reason that I feel like Ibushi is going to be the winner of the entire thing. But
definitely
if you
at
listen,
the very least, the finals.
Yeah. You listen to the way they talk, and it was all Gallagher. But
yeah, Brian Danielson developing a man crush.
Yeah, but Aichner let his match speak for himself. He didn't need anybody to speak for him. This dude might be getting a contract soon, and I am fine with
it. Surprised me. Yeah,
he's a big dude, technically sound. Well, not a big dude. You know what I mean.
Yeah, definitely. He's one of the biggest in the tournament.
Yeah. He
I'm
wasn't.
Actually very
he
surprised
wasn't
he
tiny,
made the weight.
Yeah, he wasn't a tiny little guy. Yeah, good match. I was you know, it wasn't the best one of the tournament or anything, which we will be speaking of in a minute. But it was a fine match.
How fucking great was his corner dropkick at the end, though?
Don't remember.
The running dropkick to the corner.
Where he was, he's down in the corner?
No, he was standing.
Oh no. Oh, that hurt. I felt that one. That one hurt.
It's, you know, a drop kick in the corner doesn't really sound like it would be a finisher, but when you see this one, you're like, yeah, okay, I'll buy that.
It was his words exactly. He said, I would never ever buy that as a finisher. But if I had to, I would look at that one and say, yeah, that's probably the one. that was brutal looking. I'm off the side. Whee! So yeah, it was a fun match. Like I don't fucking know. Eric, what was the final match?
The final match? Oh, wow.
That was really fucking unlikely. Ah, oh, don't push me off! Dick move!
I went with you. It makes you feel better.
A little. What was the final match, Eric?
Final match of the first round was Johnny Gargano and Tommaso Ciampa.
Really?
The two gentlemen that will be challenging the Revival for the NXT tag titles.
According to the episode of NXT that we watched 45 minutes before that.
Hmm?
Well, basically, they came out in NXT and they were talking a lot about how they were going to beat the Revival for the tag titles, and they made a lot of jokes and everything. They were just like themselves. And then, right at the start of the Cruiserweight Classic, you have the two of them backstage together, and they're looking at each other with an interviewer between them. And Gargano was like, I'm going to show you who the better man is. And Ciampa is like, are you fucking kidding me, bro? Like, it looked like the team was falling apart before our eyes. Did you have anything that you wanted to say before we start talking about the match itself?
No.
Cool. Off to a good start then. So basically the idea of this match was Gargano like, you know, he's my boy, but I'm here to win. So that's what I'm gonna do. Ciampa was like, he said some stuff, and I don't, like, he said, I normally, he said, when I hit people, I hit to hurt them, but I never hit to injure them. Tonight, I'm going to injure Gargano. So he pissed him off. He shouldn't have been talking all that shit. And man, he really slapped him around in that match.
Yeah.
But the entire story of the match was, I mean, after seeing Ciampa at Beyond, or I'm sorry, after seeing Gargano at Beyond and then seeing him on the Cruiserweight Classic, it was like, at Beyond, he really got my attention. At the Cruiserweight Classic, he's up there. I could probably see this dude, definitely see this dude as the NXT champion someday. Possibly world champion. Someday.
Yeah. Who knows?
What were your thoughts on the match?
Great match, had a good story to it. Where, you know, like you said, you know, where they were kind of friends, but, you know, but Ciampa wanted the win. And it came to that really interesting point in the match where he had Gargano down, he pulled down his knee pad, as he does sometimes, and then just couldn't bring himself to murder Johnny Gargano.
Yeah, because that's what it would have been. He stopped himself. He said, I know I wanted to win, but that's fucked up. And I believe that Gargano ran forward and gave him an enziguri. And I think that was enough to get his hold locked in. I may be missing something on the timeline.
Yeah, I mean, this was, I can't remember the exact finish, but it was one of those things where it's like, it's not even important.
Yeah. The entire match shined like a fucking diamond. It was just, how do you think it stacks up against Zayn and Owens for, like, match of the year standings? I think I might dare to say it was better.
I think I preferred Zayn and Owens. I do have to say that much.
I prefer Zayn and Owens because of how long I had known about them and everything.
Right.
I think probably we need to consider the stories of the matches.
Yeah. By the way, my controller got disconnected, so I was okay. Not driving for like 30 seconds.
Oh, I see. Yeah, like, you have to consider that the stories for the two matches were complete polar opposites.
Yeah, I can see that.
You know, the Battleground match was Zayn and Owens want to kill each other. But towards the end of the match, I'm sorry, not even towards the end of the match. What the hell am I talking about? If you remember, at one point, Owens decided that he wanted to have some mercy. He's like, stay down. Don't make me do this.
I'm here.
Eric, I see it. I'm here. I'm queer. Get used to it.
Okay.
That's not appropriate.
I'm going to stop because I was not that close to you even before my controller got disconnected.
Yeah, the pretty much the opposite goes for Ciampa and Gargano. They were best buddies and their tag team partners. And now they're in this match and they're suddenly having to beat the dog shit out of each other. And like towards the end of the match, like I said, Ciampa decided that he didn't want to kill his tag team partner. He's like, I'll do this another way, a way that doesn't fucking murder my good buddy. And Gargano saw it, took advantage, and yeah. Excellent little match. I think the difference in the story is part of the reason that you like the other one more. I think, I think the other reason is it's just who they are.
Yeah.
Because I think Owens and Zayn are probably my two favorite wrestlers right now.
Right.
Up there with Zack Sabre and Tommy and there's there's a couple of others up there. There's a lot of good stuff out there right now. It's what a fucking time to be a wrestling fan. But those are two of our favorites for sure.
Yeah.
Probably numbers one and two, and I don't even know who goes in which slot, you know?
Yeah.
I think I do, but I don't want to say it. God, I never turned off the fucking radio. It's going to be fucking blaring for this entire thing. Oh, good. Now I hear your radio. But yeah, so I think that could be why you say that was more your favorite match, or more why you say that was more the match of the year. But in terms of like just wrestling ability, you still feel the same way.
I kind of like matches that have those like crazy bumps and everything, and then you know when there's like a story behind it, and
oops,
you know, I mean, yeah. The Zayn and Owens, I mean, that was obviously not their first match against each other, so they had a lot more history to play off of, so I enjoyed that more.
That is true.
But I mean, if for whatever reason one day they had Gargano versus Ciampa again, and they kind of played off of the backstory from this match, you know, then who knows, that one could be even better.
Yeah. But as it stood, it was a fucking phenomenal match. Definitely the best one of the
first round. Yeah.
And of the rest of the tournament, we'll see.
Yeah. I heard there was a match in the second round that was fucking amazing.
Okay. Looking forward to it. So I thought that since the first round is over, that we might try looking at the brackets the way they are now, and see if we can't make some predictions for the second round.
Okay.
It's gonna be a little trickier this time. I think you know that.
Yeah, and also you're gonna have to give me a minute because I'm not looking at brackets while I'm trying to race you.
Fair enough. This race is going to be over in probably under a minute, so
yeah.
Once we get back to the selection screen, then we'll go over the matches themselves.
Okay.
So, how you holding up, Eric? As far as the podcast, we're doing a fucking Iron Man podcast here.
This one did turn out to be long as shit for whatever reason.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you why. It's because of Beyond.
Yeah. I mean, in all fairness, the show, live was about 5 hours long, so...
It's true.
I guess I should have known it would be a long podcast.
Oh boy. Oh, ooh-wee. Okay, I'm good.
Okay.
Right. So.
All right. So now, of course, I don't know what order these will be airing in, but we'll go over what we have.
Yeah, just in
okay,
order.
Okay. So. First match of the second round, we'll have Jack Gallagher versus Akira Tozawa.
Tozawa, for sure.
I would agree. Yeah, they focus on Tozawa a lot. I am, however, really excited to see more Jack Gallagher. So.
Yeah, and see, I mean that's
pretty fun.
It's going to be an awesome match anyway.
Yeah, I mean these are both guys that have a lot of personality, in addition to being competent in the ring. So, should be good watching.
Yeah.
Let's see. Then we have Tajiri versus Grand Metalik.
I think it's pretty obvious that Metalik, they want to go on. That's a tricky
yeah,
one.
I would say most likely. It is. Because, I mean, on the other hand, Tajiri has supposedly been legitimately re-signed, so who knows.
Hmm.
I want to try this chili ad one, Tim. This looks like the shit.
Oh, yeah. Shit. Oh, this is a Rockstar created one? Fuck. Okay. Yeah, they had added more, so.
Yeah. Boy, this one will be something. Drew Gulak versus Zack Sabre Jr.
Oh, why? Zack Sabre Jr., but shit. Why would they burn that so soon?
Yeah, that is going to be Matt Wrestling-tastic.
I mean, that just belongs higher up in the...
Yeah. Well, that will definitely be main eventing whichever show it's on, I'll say that much.
Yeah.
Okay. We have potential train wreck alert.
Oh, boy.
Noam Dar versus Ho-Ho Loon.
Oy, fuck. Noam Dar, I guess.
Yeah, I'll say Dar, but holy shit, it's like the two least impressive guys that went on.
No, I think the two least impressive guys that went on were the two people in that first round match.
Huh?
The two of them together, Dar and, Dar and what the fuck was the other guy's name?
And Loon, yeah.
No,
it's the two least impressive.
The two people that fought in the first round. Dar and the guy that the match we just reviewed.
Yeah, but I said the least impressive guys that advanced.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Yeah.
Okay. Then we have Brian Kendrick versus Tony Nese.
Ooh-wee.
I think I'm going to go with Kendrick on that one.
I think I'm inclined to agree. Because they did all those promos where, like, he's like, well, if I don't win, then I'm just going to go back to just existing or something like that.
Yeah.
That, like really shit to make you feel fucking bad about, like, ever smiling and shit like that. Good fucking great.
Yeah, they are going with the whole redemption thing for Kendrick, so.
Yeah.
We'll see what happens.
And
this is one of those ones that could kind of go either way.
I think you're right. I think it's obvious that they're going the Kendrick direction of this. Holy shit. What are you fucking drunk? Keep it on the road, will you? Do you remember who the next match was? This is an intense race, so feel free to not look right at the moment.
Kota Ibushi versus Cedric Alexander.
Oh, I'm sorry.
This
fucking
is the match that... what?
You mentioned Tozawa before?
Yeah.
Okay, I got confused. I thought you were talking about Ibushi. Ibushi is the one that I thought was going to win. I still keep my pick. Tozawa is going to be the winner of that match.
Yeah.
Ibushi and Cedric Alexander. I remember Cedric Alexander being fun, but Ibushi is the person that I think they want to win this tournament.
Yeah. That seems very, very likely, but... Again, I have heard that this match was amazing live. So I
That's
look forward
good.
To seeing it.
Good to hear.
Okay, let's see. What do we have next? Next we have TJ Perkins versus Johnny Gargano.
Oof. So long, TJ. It's been really fun having you.
Yeah.
But they gotta go Johnny further Gargano's with Gargano.
Gonna, right, he's gonna have to go pretty deep into this tournament at this point.
Yeah. And 2 weeks ago I would have complained about that, but after everything, no complaints here. I am quiet. Yeah. Gargano, for sure.
Yeah.
This race is fucking awesome.
Yeah, I'm really enjoying this one. It's made me forget about those user-created ones. Okay, and then the final match is Rich Swann versus Lince Dorado.
And Rich
Swann. And what will probably be the flippiest match in the tournament. Yeah,
that's
I'll agree
actually.
With that.
I don't know. That one's tough. I think
Swan is the way to go.
I think Rick Swan, just because he got his contract and they have to do something to make him look a little strong, and getting out of the first round isn't just quite doing it. They gotta take him a little bit further to establish him a little bit and then dump him into NXT.
Right. Okay, so there you have it. Our predictions for the second round. We'll see what happens.
Yeah. And just in time, this race is over.
Yeah. And this podcast with it.
Yes. Thank God. That was a long podcast.
That was. That was something else.
Eric, as always, thank you for being a part of this podcast. Thank you for the tickets to Beyond, because, like I said, one of the best shows I've ever been to, if not the single best. And you're a fucking trooper. This was a marathon podcast, and yeah, it was good stuff. Thank you for being a part of it. As always, you seem to be my regular on these things, but I appreciate it nevertheless. Okay, I will take that. I will take that as you are welcome.
Yeah. No, I was going to say, I'm sorry, I was reading the brackets again. Okay.
No problem.
So, yeah, thanks for having me, Tim.
And
yeah.
Thank you, nobody, for watching. And we will see none of you next week.
Yeah.